Very rarely you can get annular urticaria also. Here you can see the lesions are annular, and you may think of other things like even a fungal infection. So how do we investigate in urticaria? Now remember, again I told you, urticaria, no routine tests are indicated in acute urticaria unless, if you have very strong suspicions, only you should do tests. So acute urticaria, you just treat with antihistamines. In chronic urticaria, you need to do a routine diagnostic workup like ESR or CRP and full blood count. Those are very first investigations. And omission of suspected drugs like NSAIDs, and also I have seen a few cases of persistent urticaria, chronic urticaria due to lipid lowering drugs, statins, right? Even though ACE inhibitors can cause urticaria and an angioedema, the commonly used losartan, it doesn't have that much of a tendency to cause urticaria. Any other extended diagnostic workup should be based on the history. There is no point in doing an ANA, thyroid function test, vitamin D level, and the allergy panel and everything. Like I have seen patients coming with toxocar antibodies, toxoplasma antibodies, so many antibodies, right? If you are thinking about doing all these tests, I think it's better to refer the patient rather than doing it on your own. But a few guides can be given like this, like say for instance, on your examination, if you see a goiter, why not do a thyroid function test and thyroid antibodies? Especially if the thyroid function tests are abnormal, okay, you can do the thyroid antibodies. If the urticaria is lasting for more than 24 hours, of course, you are justified in doing an ANA, right? So it's like that. Based on the history only, you should do your investigations. Like, don't do investigations simply because the patient is forcing you to do. So how do we manage urticaria? Remember, the goal of treatment is absence of symptoms. So you can't tell the patient, you cannot give the patient antihistamines and say, okay, if you get one or two wheels, it doesn't matter. No, your antihistamine dose should aim at complete clearance of wheels, right? And second important thing is you have to treat the disease until it is gone. So there is no point in giving treatment, even in acute urticaria, giving treatment for 3 days, 5 days is useless. Usually, this is how I treat acute and chronic urticaria. If it is an acute urticaria, still, I give a prescription for 1 month and tell the patient, okay, you can take it for 2 weeks and stop for a day or two and see whether it is coming back. And if it is coming back, take it for 1 month. But after 1 month, you can stop and see, because most of the acute urticarias get better without any other treatment. But if it comes back again, you need longer term treatment. So you have to come back for treatment. Avoiding possible triggers. Like we discussed earlier, if it is your statins that are causing the thing, we need to think about changing that. And if it is cold urticaria, there are patients who say, I cannot take the frozen food out of the fridge. The moment I open the fridge and freezer and put my hand in, I start getting this. So that is cold urticaria, because I didn't go into the details, but physical urticarias, aquagenic pruritus, the aquagenic urticarias, all these are there. Like, I'm sure you may have come across at least one person who says, "Doctor, I can't take a bath." Now that I have started talking about aquagenic urticarias, I will talk about the management here itself. Now, there are patients who say they cannot take a bath. They can wash their faces because the contact with water is only for a few minutes, but a bath involves longer term contact with the water. So they say, "I cannot take a bath." Right? Some say it's only with cold water, some say it's only with hot water, but for some, whether it's hot water or cold water, so it's the water, right? The contact with water. Now, this is here, you cannot avoid the triggers. So the few tricks that I use are, like, say, for instance, if somebody says, "Doctor, I get this every time when I come back from work and have my bath." So I tell the patients, "Okay, you take the night dose before you leave the office. So you give the body time to digest the tablet and, keep your system ready for this surge of histamines." Right? So you let the tablet time to act and then go and have your bath. Even in the morning, like, you take the tablet early in the morning, first thing in the morning, and then you get your wash, right? And the second important thing about this aquagenic urticaria is, say, it's not always, but say somebody goes on a trip and, like, goes for a river bath or a sea bath. So you are sort of waist deep in the water. And you are just, when you are doing that sort of thing, you are very relaxed. You forget about everything, and your entire lower half of the body is now underwater, in contact with the water, right? And they may even collapse because the entire body is now goes into waves, right? Not the entire body, entire the lower half, right? Therefore, you have to warn them, okay, if you go on a trip, no river bathing, no sea bathing, right? Even taking a tablet and doing it may be harmful. At least your friend should know that you have this problem. If you really, really want to do it, make sure that your patient is a compliant person, right? They can take the antihistamine and do it, but the friends, everyone who is there in the water with him should know that there is such a problem, and if there's anything, they have to get him out, right? Especially remember, this can cause drowning if they collapse in even in a very small pool of water, they can drown, right? For swimming, again, that may be a problem. Again, they may try swimming after taking a dose of antihistamine, right? So, specific changes in diet are not recommended usually, but practically, I tell them, okay, don't take things that can cause allergy, right? So then they are also happy. Then, with what do we treat? The first line of treatment is modern second generation antihistamines. I will tell you what they are. Just remember, the first line is the usual dosage. So for a adult person, fexofenadine 180 milligrams, desloratadine or levocetirizine 5 milligrams, loratadine 10 milligrams, like that, right? So these are the modern second generation antihistamines in usual dosage. The second line is not adding a second drug. Second line is updosing. So if you have given fexofenadine and patient says, "Doctor, I'm getting a few wheals, but I'm better," you double the dose, make it 360 milligrams. Okay, you can go up to four times the usual dose with many of these antihistamines. And you have to warn the patient, okay, the pharmacy guy will say this is too much, but I'm telling you this can be given, right? You may use short courses of corticosteroids early in the disease. So, what are the drugs that can be given? Fexofenadine, the starting dose for adults is 180 milligram daily. Levocetirizine, loratadine, desloratadine. Montelukast can also be used. We usually reserve it for a second line drug, right? And I told you about avoiding sedating antihistamines as they may cause cognitive impairment. Especially in school children, don't think about giving piriton, phenagan. Even like we use hydroxyzine or Atarax as a last resort, right? But that also causes sedation to a great degree. My rule of thumb is treat chronic urticaria with the antihistamine or histamines, the combination that cause complete clearance for at least 3 months, right? So I warn the patients, okay, this has to be taken for 3 months before we think about reducing. Then again, I sort of tail off, right? But coming to urticaria special situations in children, same principles as for adults, and the dose should be adjusted to weight and age. And remember, fexofenadine is not recommended for children less than 6 years of age. In pregnancy and lactation, loratadine is preferred. Loratadine, desloratadine, both can be used, right? Okay, so I think that's about urticaria. Yes. Now we come to, now we talked about a common problem. Now we are coming to a not very common, but very important problem. Now, this young man in his early 20s came to me and said, "Doctor, I'm working in a bank far away from home. So I stayed there for the 5 working days and come back home on Friday night. And I have had this for the past 7 months. I have been to several doctors. I was given several courses of antibiotics. Now this is in his wrist, right? I think it was a right wrist, right? And the lesion progressed in spite of treatment. So this is obviously not a bacterial infection to respond to antibiotics, right? So where have we gone wrong? First thing is, we forgot that this is a large painless lesion, unlikely to be acute infection. We forgot that he works in an area endemic for leishmaniasis. Therefore, we didn't consider leishmaniasis as our differential diagnosis. Now, when I'm talking to you about leishmaniasis, I want you to remember two things. The first thing is you need to know the distribution of leishmaniasis in Sri Lanka. Therefore, you are able to guess, right? The second important thing is you should know like that it can occur with very varying presentations, and you should be aware of those. So I'm teaching you only these two, because the treatment of leishmaniasis has to be done at a dermatology clinic. Therefore, you are not supposed to treat leishmaniasis on your own, right? Okay, now what is cutaneous leishmaniasis? It's due to a protozoan. In Sri Lanka, the organism causing leishmaniasis is Leishmania donovani. It's the organism that causes visceral leishmaniasis in other countries. Right? Our organism, Leishmania donovani, it's called Zymodium mon-37, which is a very specific, typical organism. This is typical to Sri Lanka. So we have our own Leishmania organism, right? Therefore, this disease has been there in this country for a long, long period. But it came into the limelight only for the past 30 years or so. So it's actually the history of leishmaniasis for Sri Lanka is only about 3 decades. But there have been cases reported even before, right? It's due to a protozoan transmitted by sand flies. So we have sand flies all over the country. It's endemic in southern and north central provinces. Like, for example, in the north central province, Padavia, Talawa, Tambuthegama, Padavia, those are Leishmania endemic areas. So much so that we have a dermatologist appointed to Padavia before. I mean, that was a priority area because of Leishmaniasis. Right? The dermatologist at Thangala, that person's main problem is Leishmaniasis, right? So Dikwala is probably Dikwala, Thangala, those are the like Leishmaniasis Mahagedera in the south, right? But cases have been reported from the northern and central provinces, but this is, now you will see the distribution later and you will see how it is changing. Even Gampaha Mirigama is a pocket now, right? In the north central province, like I'll just tell you how it spreads, right? Now, in Polonnaruwa, when I started in 2008, there were only 24 cases for the whole year. Next year, it doubled. The year after, that number doubled. So we had about 200 cases in the third year. And that was 2010, just after the war ended. And we were getting confirmed LTT carders who came for rehabilitation to all this Kandakadu, Valikanda, that area, right? So in 2010, about one third of our patients were these Tamil LTT carders. Then we started seeing the army personnel manning the place getting Leishmaniasis, and then the people in the surrounding villages. The same happened in, I think, Dimbulagala. Just off Dimbulagala, there was another camp, right? So these two, the Valikanda and Dimbulagala, were the least prevalent MOH areas for us. Then it changed because these people brought the infection from the north, and then the sand flies spread it all over. So that is how a pocket is formed in a relatively less prevalent area, right? So let's see how it presents. Non-healing nodule, plaque, or ulcerated or crusted nodule. Effective treatment is there, so they need to be referred to a dermatology clinic. Okay. Now you see the positive case detection for the past 10, 11, 12 years, right? Now you look here. In 2016, we had 1,253 cases, 1,500 cases and in 2017. And 2018, it more than doubled to 3,271. And 2019, it was almost 4,000. Oh, remember, these are only reported cases, right? The actual number may be higher. And 2020 was a time of lull, right? We had less clinics. Some areas, the clinics were closed completely. Even with that, in 2020, we had again 3,162. Now, compare it with leprosy. We usually have about 2,000 cases of leprosy. In 2019, we had 1,700 odd cases. And last year, we had only around 700 cases. Patients did not present with leprosy. Not that the prevalence went down, but they were not presenting with leprosy. Now look at Leishmaniasis. Leishmaniasis prevalence has not gone down at all, right? So you see, it is a real problem. Look at this. Again, concentrate on the red, the yellow highlighted area. Now, this first one is Gampaha. You see, 68 has gone up to 174, right? And Mathale, about 6, 7, 8 years ago, Mathale had only about 13 cases. Now, 288 and 348 last year. This is for 2020, 348 in 2020, right? So Gampaha, Mathale, these are new pockets. Even the prevalence in Kandy is going up. You see, Kandy was 5 8 years ago, now 79, right? Again, Kurunagala, 61, 8 years ago, now almost 500. Ratnapura, 18, 8 years ago, 150. Kagala, there were two, like when I was working in the Kegal district at Karavanalla, we had very few cases. And I was like thrilled to see a case of leishmaniasis. Now you see 70 and 52, right? So you see, we are now seeing formation of new pockets. So if you are in any of these areas, or if you have somebody who has gone to the, now, earlier in our history, it was very easy to ask. Katharagama giyada, Anuradhapura polonnaru giyada. So those were the things which we needed to ask. Now, have you been to Kegal? Have you been to Ratnapura? Right? In Homagama, I had so many cases of people who have worked in Vallavaya, Ambilipitiya, those areas, right? So these people who are working in the cane plantations, all these have to be considered. And also, I had at least two or three cases at Homagama where the patients had no travel history at all, right? And I know that there is a new pocket being formed in somewhere around Hangvela. Right. So the disease is here to stay. That is why it's very, very important that every doctor knows about leishmaniasis. Right. Okay. Coming to clinical features. The early lesions would be acneiform papules. Can you all see the one here? I can't see it in this view. Acneiform. Painless acneiform lesions which occur in exposed areas. So in Sri Lanka, the commonest site is the upper limb, then the face, right? So it's either the face, neck, the upper limbs, and rarely in the lower limbs. But sometimes, especially in males, you can get lesions in the trunk, because in Sri Lanka, a lot of males go bare body. Then it progresses to a crusted nodule. You can see that there's a crust here, there's a crust here, and you can see that there's some epidermal change, a bit of papularity, papular nature here, or scaling here. And like a very important feature in leishmaniasis is skin induration, right? Right, skin induration, which is like if you induration is like if you touch the lesion, it feels somewhat firm. Right now, even though the lesion looks like it is only here, the induration may extend up to about here. Right, so this entire lesion is something like this. And again, you can see that the person is dark and you have this hypopigmentation. It's called a hypopigmented halo. So these crusted nodules with the hypopigmented halo, right? Still, the lesions are painless. Plaques, they may show crusting like in this lesion. Now, this is an elbow, right? So elbow is a very common site for leishmaniasis. Again, you see, this is one place where the elbow is one place where an insect can perch on and bite, right? Same for the tip of the nose and the top of the ear, right? Ulcerated lesions. Even when they are, now these are the biopsy marks, even when they are ulcerated, they may not show much of a pain. Right? Sometimes they can have multiple lesions. You can see 1, 2, 3 here. So 3 bites have occurred. 1 bite here, 1 bite here. Right? So multiple lesions can occur. Some people have this photodermatitis-like rash. So the extensor upper limbs, back of the neck, front of the neck here, the V area and the front of the neck. This sort of rash. Sometimes it is because of this rash, the patient comes to you, not because of the leishmaniasis, right? Now here, the lesion was somewhere here, right? On the, yes, the lesion is here, right? The lesion is here, the rash, the patient became because of the rash, not because of the lesion. Facial plaques. This one right in front of the ear, right? They're just with the sideburn. Right here, in between the eyes. Again, on top of the right eyebrow. On the forehead, this patient was brought by a doctor, a professional's mother. And this took at least 6 weeks to heal, right? Again, right here on the temple, right? And one very bad thing about facial plaques is they can be persistent and they can be resistant to treatment, right? Okay, facial nodules. Again, see, it's on the cheek, right? Right where the cheek is most prominent and too close to the eye. This lady is lucky. She had only a small nodule which can be injected. But here again, right below the eye. Or the nose. I told you these are the areas where they can perch and bite. Right, like this. Okay. So you have tip of the nose is a typical site. And you have one here like... This is the typical site for a basal cell carcinoma, right? So, like your DD should be basal cell carcinoma. Lip lesions. This one. You see, this lady also came because she had a photodermatitis-like rash. So, a very small lesion, but positive. Or this ulcer, which could even have been a carcinoma of the lip. And for both these lesions, carcinoma is the differential diagnosis. The ear. Could be like this. Again, the easiest site to perch is the cartilaginous part. Again, remember, for leprosy, it's the ear lobe. For leishmaniasis, it's the upper part, the cartilaginous part of the ear. So if you are lucky, you may end up like this. But if you are unlucky, it may be more extensive and even the cartilage is involved, or it could be so bad like this. Now, remember, all these pictures I showed you, they are not from the internet. They are all in my collection. Patients collected over like 4 years in Polonnaruwa. And then afterwards, whatever I collected were the rare cases that came in Caravanella and Homagama. So most of these patients were from my Polonnaruwa collection. Right now, you see, it's not uncommon. And compared with this, this is called Chiclerose ulcer. This is, now if you can remember your faculty days, there are two types of leishmaniasis, new world and old world. Now what we have is old world leishmaniasis. This is new world leishmaniasis, which occurs in the Central Americas, right? So this is due to a specific organism causing a new world leishmaniasis. But compare this with either this or this, right? So we have, our organism has a wide variety, right? We can mimic any kind of leishmaniasis occurring anywhere in the world. Right. So how do you suspect leishmaniasis? The typical lesions, the asymptomatic lesions, which are of long duration. Then the epidemiology. Now I showed you the districts to be suspicious, right? So, southern, north central, northwestern, central provinces, and also areas like in Sabaragamuwa, Ratnapura is a likely site, Pathale is a likely site, especially Nowla, like the first focus was in Nowla. Then, if you remember the map, Mathale Naula, and then you have Alahara Bakamuna, right? Those are somewhat closer to that area. So we were seeing pockets like the Naula pocket was well known for about 20 years. Then I by the time I left Polannaruwa, I was seeing in Alahara Bakamuna. So that was spillover from Naula, right? So any history of visits to such an area within the last year? Very rarely persons returning from the Middle East, especially Saudi, like the history that I have seen is these are people who go as housemaids or like, you know, in places, especially in Saudi, where their living conditions are really, really bad. They are not given good accommodation, and most of these people have tended for goats, right? Now, in most of these countries, there are goats in their households, and if the women, especially the housemaids, if they have tended for goats, they come with these large multiple lesions, right? Actually, I remember the very first patient. As a registrar, the very first patient we diagnosed in the NHSL clinic was someone who has returned from the Middle East with multiple lesions. Right? So how to manage a suspected case? In your practice, if you think it is acute, try an adequate course of antibiotics, either cloxicillin or erythromycin for 5 days. Actually, now it should be flucloxacillin. Especially if the lesion is of a relatively short duration. If it does not settle with antibiotics, refer to the nearest skin clinic and just give your DD as, like, say, query leishmaniasis. Again, like leprosy, if you query leishmaniasis, they will be given priority. Right? So why should we treat cutaneous leishmaniasis? The first thing is, for us now, at the moment, the best control measure is treatment of cases to reduce the reservoir. Right? Because we still don't know a lot about the sand fly. So sand fly control is not we don't have a lot of evidence-based methods for vector control. Right, because we are still learning about the vector. Therefore, the best thing is to treat the cases to reduce the reservoir of infection. And then I showed you how the number of cases is increasing. So it's rapidly increasing. And if there were almost 3,100 cases last year, again, you have to assume that there were at least 5,000 cases during the previous year, right? Self-healing may occur, but there may be scarring. Chronicity may be a problem. I didn't show you a lot of pictures. Now, look back, think back what you saw. Remember those pictures. And if you have any query that any of your patients is having leishmaniasis, refer to the nearest dermatology clinic. Again, a very important thing. I told you the organism causing cutaneous leishmaniasis in Sri Lanka is Leishmania donovani. So Leishmania donovani can visualize. But luckily, we have shown that none of the people who are having cutaneous leishmaniasis, the disease does not visualize. That means if you have cutaneous leishmaniasis somewhere, you are very, very unlikely to have a hepatosplenomegaly or chronic fever due to Kalaza. Kalaza occurs alone without cutaneous, right? So there may be a slight difference between the two organisms, right? Anyway, I know that at least 9 cases of visceral leishmaniasis have been reported in Sri Lanka. So these are reported cases, right? So we don't know whether there have been any cases which are not reported, but I mean diagnosed, right? And again, I didn't show you the pictures, but primary mucosal leishmaniasis has been there. Even a case which resembles mucocutaneous leishmaniasis also has been there, right? So, I mean, our organism is very versatile, right? It can do whatever it wants. So that is why we need to keep it in check, not let it go wild like what's happening everywhere else in the country. Okay, so I think that's all for leishmaniasis. We are coming to case three, not a very long thing, but you see this 14-year-old girl with whitish lesions on the upper right upper eyelid and temple for 7 months. There were no other lesions. There was no family history of treatment, similar problems, and this child was treated with topical antifungals and reassured that it is Aluha. So where have we gone wrong? Firstly, it was the wrong diagnosis. It's not Aluha. You see that there is depigmentation here, right? It's not hypopigmentation, it's depigmentation, right? Therefore, there was a delay in starting treatment. So we come to the diagnosis here, which is vitiligo, which is an acquired loss of pigmentation with absence of epidermal melanocytes. Epidermal melanocytes. The melanocytes may remain in the hair follicles, and those are the things we loan to give back pigmentation, right? The exact etiology is unknown. There is obviously a genetic predisposition, and autoimmunity may play a role, and it can be associated with several autoimmune conditions. A family history is seen in about 30% of our cases, right? So why should we think more about the management? Cosmetic concerns are very important now for this girl. The cosmetic concern is very, very important, right? Stigma, fear of disfigurement, they are all very important aspects in the management. So, I mean, if you come to a diagnosis of vitiligo, I would say, I usually don't use the word sudukabara, which is a very, very stigmatizing. I mean, the word kabara is not used for anything good, right? Starting from the kabara goya, sudukabara, potukabara, all these are sort of, I mean, if I have heard people being, you know, if you want to put them down, you call them kabareya or kabari, right? So these are very stigmatizing words. So most of the times what I do is, I will just say make a sudhu enava vage. Or I will say you, in this patch, you are not able to produce the pigment. That's all, right? Let's not call this a name. That's what I say, tell my patients, right? Okay. So clinically, it's a depigmentation versus hypopigmentation. And sometimes even the hairs within the lesions may be white. That means the melanin within the hair follicles also has been lost, right? The commonest is the generalized type, but acrofacial involvement is resistant to treatment, right? Okay. There is a condition called segmental vitiligo, which is actually what was happening in that girl I showed you. Segmental vitiligo occurring over a localized area. It occurs early, especially it's common in children. Very unlikely to generalize. So one very good thing you can tell the mother of that child with the lesions here is, okay, we need a little time to treat this, but don't worry, your child is not going to become white completely, right? Okay. Something good to know, the diseases associated with autoimmune disorders associated with vitiligo. So you see thyroid disease, pernicious anemia, diabetes, Halonevus, I'll show you Halonevus later. Even malignant melanoma can be associated with vitiligo. Now, especially think of vitiligo, generalized vitiligo. Now, these people have a loss of melanin in an extensive area of body area. And this is a tropical country. So if they go out, like these people with extensive vitiligo, if they go out and if they are out in the sun for long, I mean, I had this elderly, not really elderly, she was in her 60s. She was working in a rubber plantation, but not as a rubber tapper. She was sort of cleaning that, cleaning in the sense she was weeding the plantation. So she was out there, like all throughout the day, she was out there. And she had several, like she had extensive vitiligo, about which she was not bothered at all. But she had several pre-malignant lesions and one or two obvious squamous cell carcinomas, right? So you have to think about the malignancy risk in vitiligo in that context. Vitiligo can be like this. You see this boy, this is a very dermatomal-like distribution. And you can see the polyosis, the white hairs here. Now this is an adolescent boy just beginning a beard, right? And that beard, unfortunately, is becoming white. And you can see this one here. Now this person is lucky because every time he's keeping the eyes open, the lesion gets sort of, obliterated. Generalized vitiligo, you see that it can usually merge with the surrounding skin, and there are islands of pigmentation within, and you have these dark pigmented areas, complete pigment loss areas, and these light brown areas. So this is called a trichrome vitiligo, right? Now this person, a young male, has a patch of vitiligo on the scalp, and you can see this patch of white hair, right? So the vitiligenous skin and the white hairs. Now it's very important that you consider the differential diagnosis here. Sometimes vitrisis versicolor can be mistaken for early vitiligo, right? So the two can look similar. Leprosy, sometimes some leprosy lesions can be very white. I don't know whether you can see the lesion here. There is a lesion right on top of the right eyebrow, right? Now these are more important things. Now these two pictures are from patients who are having systemic sclerosis. Especially now look at this. This is called speckled leucoderma. Leucoderma is actually similar to vitiligo, but this is speckled, right? You see, speckling is like a small crystals or something being strolled, like ara visurovala aralavadi. So this is not like the vitiligo here, right? This is there's more speckling. And usually you see it along the hairline, right? And this young boy, he was about 12 or 13, and he was referred to our clinic in Polonnaruwa with the diagnosis of vitiligo. Yes, there are depigmented patches. You see them here, here, here. But you also see loss of the sausage-shaped fingers. Loss of finger pulp. You see how short this index finger, the last phalanx of this index finger is. There's loss of finger pulp here, loss of finger pulp here, and this one is again shortened, right? This middle finger is no longer than the second or the fourth fingers, right? So this is an obvious case of fairly advanced, obvious case of scleroderma, right? Luckily diagnosed at that point because somebody thought of vitiligo, but this is not vitiligo, right? Okay, this is what's called a halo nevus, where you get a nevus, a pigmented nevus was there for a long time and then developed a white halo around that. Now, this guttate hypomelanosis, you won't see this sort of very clear, demarcated large lesions. This is a dermoscopy picture, right? I didn't have a clinical picture. Now, think of, even like you may see this even in your parents, or sometimes if you are like over 40 or so, even in your body, you may be having one or two lesions like this. Now, these are very well demarcated porcelain white lesions with a like very nice border. Okay, and they commonly occur in the shins, and with advancing age, the number of lesions increases. This is a sign of skin aging, right? Gut it hypomelanosis, we don't treat it, but at least we see at least one case per week of patients with gut it hypomelanosis coming for treatment because they feared vitiligo, right? So this is a condition where you can just reassure the patient and says, okay, look, this is not no different from your hairs becoming gray, right? So if you accept the loss of pigmentation in your hairs, just accept the loss of pigmentation in your body also, right? Because we cannot treat it, we cannot reverse it. It's just skin aging, right? And I mean, the most important thing is to reassure them that it is not vitiligo. This condition is again commonly seen, not very common, and this is not a condition which is described in standard textbooks. This is something we are seeing in Asian young people. In their late teens to maybe, like this persists, but the onset may be in the late teens or 20s or even 30s. You see, these are fairly young legs, right? And you see, this is not like gutted hypomelanosis. This is now, these are not very well demarcated. These are not depigmented. These are hypopigmented. And they have been there for years and years and years. Right? We were trying to describe this as a new entity, but like I also couldn't complete this work. If you do a biopsy, the only thing that comes even close is the features are for a post-inflammatory hypopigmentation, like as if there had been some trauma to the skin and then the skin became hypopigmented. So the why I'm showing you here is like if you see this sort of like there's no complete depigmentation, there's no very well demarcated lesions, but just a, you know, very mottled, hypopigmented, and usually they are symmetrical, appearance in the legs of young people, commoner in males as far as I know. Don't try to treat them with strong steroids or tacrolimus, right? Because this is very, very resistant to treatment. And I mean, you are just spending the patient's money. Okay? Right. So how should vitiligo be tackled in general practice? Take a good history, examine the patient, decide on the extent of involvement. If you are sure that it is a localized or a sort of segmental vitiligo, reassure the patient and the parents that it's not going to involve the whole body, right? And now I showed you so many differential diagnoses because you need, I mean, if you have lesions on the shins, there are at least three things you have to consider: vitiligo, gutted hypomelanosis, and this other condition which we don't have a proper name, right? So you should be able to think of all these, and like maybe if you're not sure of the diagnosis, best thing is to refer, right? And don't alarm the patient. Don't say that don't do things like that. If you are in doubt, refer to a dermatologist for confirmation of the diagnosis. But if you are sure that the diagnosis is vitiligo, you can try topical steroids. Don't think about putting them on oral steroids, or now there are other treatments that are being promoted like Ginkgo, right? So leave those to the experts. You can treat, like, say, again, remember your steroids depending on the region. So what I would suggest is use hydrocortisone for the face. You can use ori paste for the lips. especially whitening. And you can use betamethasone ointments for the body, including the palms and soles, right? Basically, that's what I also do. I give different steroids for different regions of the body. And I sometimes add the tacrolimus. And my preferred steroid is dexamethasone, right? Dexamethasone is not promoted, especially in the Western guidelines, because the dose that they are recommending is about 10, the pulse strength is about 10 milligrams, but we give something like 2, 3, 4 milligrams, right? So the risk of diabetes is very low in those. But again, you have to remember that vitiligo can be associated with diabetes. Therefore, be very careful about putting them on steroids. I would rather you don't use oral steroids, but you can use your topical steroids, right? And there are other treatments. Therefore, if there's extensive involvement, like the things that have worked well for me are steroids, levamisole, and phototherapy. Like actually, when I was in Caravanella, there was a, like the Caravanella clinic was famous for vitiligo. That's because we were, like, our clinic was relatively small compared to the clinics in other areas, and we had a phototherapy machine. We had the chance, we had the freedom to use it for vitiligo. Therefore, I put a few patients with generalized vitiligo into the machine, the PUA. And they, not PUA, it was UVB, and they got better. And then word spread, and like even now, I think Caravanella is having a large patient base of vitiligo because of that. Right. The last case for the day, but which this is a condition which is called the dermatologist's bread and butter. A 33-year-old male, post-COVID, day 20. You can see the scalp scaling here, itching on the scalp with scaling. And there's itchy papule eruption. Yeah, you can see it even on the ears, behind the ears, forehead, cheeks, neck, and chest. So COVID, the patient didn't go to a doctor for treatment, called the pharmacy, and was given a triple combination, steroid, antifungal, antibiotic, and cetrimide shampoo. Poor response to treatment. And like post-COVID, you are very worried that the skin problem is a sinister sign that you are going to get something like, with all the things that patients are being bombarded with in the media. So the patient came for treatment. What are the important facts here? Now, this is post-COVID day 20, right? There's very likely that the patient didn't have a bath for at least 2 weeks, right? Now this is a very sort of sensitive point for Sri Lankans. If you're having a respiratory problem, you don't have a bath, right? Pneumonia headache. So I have seen patients who have not had a bath for 1 month or even longer, 5 weeks even, right? Because there are rumors doing the rounds. There are certain doctors, especially Ayurvedic, promoting no bathing for 1 month, 2 months. And patients are even told that ahawal doctor kiwa naan nepa maasa deka. So they are not taking a bath. So you know that if you have dandruff, even 2 days of not washing the scalp will worsen the dandruff. So this patient, the simple reason why the dandruff got worse is because lack of washing of hair, right? So because this is a young male, seborrheic dermatitis is very likely. And then you need to know that seborrheic dermatitis is likely to be persistent. And you need to reassure the patient as he may have a fear of COVID. Okay, so seborrheic dermatitis is a very, very common problem. There may be different presentations at different ages. In infancy, it's the cradle cap and the infantile seborrheic dermatitis. It's rare in young children. because they have less, I mean, the sebaceous gland activity in young children is actually almost non-existent. Therefore, they cannot have scalp seborrhea. So if they, I mean, the most they can have is a scalp scaling, not a seborrhea, a scaling. And almost all cases that is associated with atopic conditions, right? Then in adolescents, usually dandruff associated with acne, and adults, classic seborrheic dermatitis. So this picture is from the internet. The cradle cap and like the areas occurring in an adult, right? So the scalp, adherent scaling in the scalp, and these kind of scaly lesions. So in the management of cradle cap in a baby, first thing is you need to reassure the parents. You can use 1% cetrimide shampoo to wash the scalp. You can use it 2 to 3 times a week. And you have to ask the mother not to try and remove the scales. For these adherent scales in the scalp, the best thing would be like ask the mother. Now, most of our mothers, when they are breastfeeding, they usually, you know, just stroke the scalp or the head of the baby, right? So what I tell them is, okay, you take a little oil or aqueous cream into your fingers and, you know, do this, just do this while you are feeding. So now these sort of babies are being breastfed every 2 to 3 hours. So they invariably get a bit of an oil massage at least 2 3 times a day. And that sort of loosens up the scale, and then it falls off, or it goes off when the baby is being bathed, right? So that is a very good thing, and I mean, mothers would love to do that. And for the rest of the body, you can use 1% hydrocortisone alone or in combination with antifungals. Things like Dactocort, Candocort can be used, right? And you need to use measures to reduce sweating, because with sweating, this gets worse, right? So the child has to be kept sort of cool, right? Not bundled up in a lot of clothes. This is another presentation of seborrheic dermatitis in children, right? This you see a fairly well-defined scaly rash around the eyes, and they may have scaling in the scalp also. So you can use, depending on the child's age, you can use cetrimide shampoo, or in older children, you can use ketoconazole also to the scalp. And you can use hydrocortisone cream at night to these lesions, but you have to ask them to stop the hydrocortisone the moment the scaling goes. But you can ask them to use emollients on a regular basis, something like aqueous cream to the eyelids, to, you know, prevent further scaling, and ask them to use the cetrimide or the ketoconazole shampoo for a longer period. Remember, you are applying this on the upper and lower eyelids, and the steroid can get absorbed, and there is a risk of glaucoma. Therefore, nothing more than hydrocortisone, right? Even dermatologists will not use anything more than hydrocortisone. So don't try to be smart. Don't try betamethasone on the eyelids, right? Okay. In adolescents and adults, seborrheic dermatitis can be like this: the scalp, the chest, the scaly lesions. Right? So is it dandruff or psoriasis? Usually in dandruff, the lesions, scalp lesions are confined to from the area within the hairline. So it won't cross the hairline and come into the forehead, most of the instances. But sometimes even severe dandruff, severe seborrheic dermatitis, there will be a little bit of extension onto the forehead, but basically it's confined. In psoriasis, it comes out. Right, then in dandruff, if you go on removing the scales, you will end up with oozing, just serous fluid. In psoriasis, if you go on removing, you will end up with bleeding. Right, those are the two main things, and also in psoriasis, you get somewhat well-defined plaques in seborrheic dermatitis, it will be like, say, the patient will say, either I have acne on my scalp, or there are these papules in the scalp, or bitter scalp scaling, which is not very well defined. That is seborrheic dermatitis. But in psoriasis, you will usually get well-defined lesions. The fourth thing about scalp psoriasis is the scales are so thick that the hairs are matted together into the scales, and it's very difficult to comb and remove, right? So that matted together hairs are again more in favor of psoriasis. Okay, so how do we manage? Like, I'll give a few tips. Now, shampooing 2 to 3 times a week, not daily. You can use cetrimide and ketoconazole. Coal tar has to be reserved for extreme conditions. And remember, coal tar has this potential for malignancy. So, I mean, it's not advisable to start young children on coal tar and let them continue it for their adult life, right? You may add a steroid lotion to the scalp if the scaling is severe. You have the full range, like starting from desonide. You have desonide lotion, mometasone lotion, betamethasone lotion, betamethasone plus salicylic acid, clobetasol plus salicylic acid. So depending on how severe the scaling is, you may use one of these. And for the skin lesions, we usually use mild steroid and antifungal creams. We avoid betamethasone, we avoid clobetasol for the skin lesions, right? And it's better to use a retinoid cream on the face of adolescents. Like, sometimes they have this scaling on the sides of the nose, right? And acne on the face. So what I do is, like, I show them which one has the seborrheic dermatitis and put a very mild steroid onto these. But for the rest of the face, I go for a retinoid, either the tretinoin cream or adapalene cream or gel, right? And you have to warn the patient that it may recur on abrupt stopping of treatment. Like, if you stop the treatment just like that, like, say, usually what happens is we put them on either doxycycline or itraconazole. They get better. They stop everything. And it comes back with a vengeance, right? So what I usually tell them is, okay, you go step down. Reduce the frequency of applications and then stop. Prefer if generalized lesions are there or if you have a doubt of psoriasis. And also remember, persistent seborrheic dermatitis is a condition where you have to look for HIV. So, you know how difficult it is to get somebody in the private sector to do a HIV screening. But if you go to a clinic, they can be easily persuaded to do HIV test, right? Because there have been a few cases of persistent seborrheic dermatitis where we had missed the diagnosis of HIV, right? Okay, I think that's the end. Thank you so much. And I'm sure there are some questions.
Thank you very much, madam, for that excellent presentation. You have almost covered all the common presentations in our dermatological practice. And it's really good to go with the case scenarios, the real actual scenarios. Yes, madam, we have a few questions. Before that, I would like to thank you on behalf of GMOI and Society for Health Research and Innovation, madam, for that wonderful presentation and the lecture. And you're ever ready and always available for us for academic activities. So let's move to the questions, madam. So we have got a first question. What is the duration of treatment for echogenic urticaria? Is it lifelong treatment?
For some, yes, it is lifelong treatment. Actually, echogenic urticaria, I think it's the most important thing is to explain to the patient why this is happening. And then explain to them how they can avoid it. Like Say, when you say you are allergic to water, but there is no way you can avoid using water, they will understand. And then, like, timing the treatment with the exposure to water. It's very difficult to say whether they get better or whether they go on, because, I mean, invariably the patient gets fed up at some point and then they will, you know, stop coming for treatment. Yes, but I would say in some patients, it's sort of lifelong.
Thank you, madam. Next question is, how to morphologically differentiate annular urticaria and tinea infection?
Again, go back to basics. Annular urticaria, even though it may look like a tinea, if you are lucky to see the lesion, urticaria is invariably less than 24 hours duration. Tinea infection will not be like that, right? And also you will see more scaling and, you know, if you take a history properly, you will not miss it, right? Tinea infection, to see an annular lesion, it has to be there in that particular location for at least 2 to 3 weeks. Otherwise, it will not look like a ringworm or an annular lesion, right? But for urticaria, I told you by definition, the urticaria duration is less than 24 hours. Secondly, because the histamine is used up in a particular area, the lesion will not recur in the same site on the next day. So it will recur on another site, right? Therefore, it's not difficult. All you need to do is take a history, right? One very important question to ask is, has this been here without changing for several days? If it is so, I think you better not think about urticaria, but think of tinea.
Thank you, madam. Same like a question, how to differentiate between lupus vulgaris and the Leishmania's lesion, especially on face?
You will not be able to differentiate clinically. When you get that sort of plaque lesions, we never jump into a diagnosis of lupus vulgaris or leishmaniasis or leprosy. One way of doing that would be like, especially if you think of leprosy, we can do one quick way of differentiating it would be, like, say you get a plaque, your DDs are lupus vulgaris, leprosy, leishmaniasis. For leprosy and leishmaniasis, you can do slit skin smears and do 2 different stains. For leprosy, it's a modified Zeal-Nielsen stain. For leishmaniasis, it's a Leishman stain. So all you have to do is take a slit skin smear. I think in most hospitals now, there are PHLTs available to do that work. So you send to them and get them to do the smears, right? And stain with the 2 different things. If it is Zeal-Nielsen positive, it's leprosy. If it is Leishman stain positive, it's leishmaniasis. If it is negative, nothing is excluded. So you have to go for a biopsy, right? That's the way, slit skin smear, biopsy. Sometimes we even do, like when we do a biopsy, we send a facial plaque. It's not easy to do several biopsies, but at least we try to take one single large biopsy, cut it and send for Leishmania culture for TB culture and special stains. So that's how we differentiate. Clinically, no.
Thank you, ma'am. And the next question is about the dose of fexofenadine. Whether can we give the fexofenadine 720 milligram as an octet dose, a single dose, or should we divide it into several doses?
No. If you're going for that sort of dose, give it in divided doses. I also haven't given 720. Actually, I have given 3 tablets, like 1 in the morning, 2 at night kind of thing.
All right. Okay, thank you, ma'am. Next three questions are regarding vitiligo. The first question is how to treat lip vitiligo. I think madam has already explained that with the ori paste.
I have one thing to add to that, like ori paste. I can't remember the drug name there. I think it's a steroid. I can't remember the name. The other thing you can add is tacrolimus. You can add tacrolimus 0.1% ointment at night. Those are the two things, but you have to warn the patient that it may persist. Lip is very difficult site to treat. And also another thing I do is, like, say if they have mucosal, more in the mucosal part of the lip, I just reassure them, no, don't treat, because you can use ori paste, but other than that, you can't use any of these other things, and it's inside your mouth. Therefore, usually we treat vitiligo because of the disfigurement. So disfigurement is not there. But then you have to warn them about two things. One is, like, say, now this is loss of pigment, loss of melanin in the mucosal surfaces. So if your mouth has lost its melanin has a very important role to play in preventing carcinogenesis or sort of stopping carcinogenesis. Therefore, you should not put carcinogens in your mouth. No betel chewing, no smoking. Right? Those two you have to tell the patient if they have either lip or mucosal vitiligo, right?
Thank you, madam. And the next question is whether vitiligo exacerbated with sunlight?
It's like this. Some people actually, they get repigmentation with sunlight. That is why we use UVB. But in some, vitiligo can get exacerbated with sunlight. And also remember, if the vitiligo is very extensive, without the melanin protection, if they go out in the sun without using any sun protective measures, they can get several things. One is they can get sunburn. Second thing is they can get photoaging very quickly. So the upper limbs may age very quickly with vitiligo. Third thing is the possibility of malignancy, like I described to you.
Thank you, madam. And the next question is, does segmental vitiligo cross midline?
It may. But most of the times, it doesn't.
Okay. Madam, next we have a case scenario for you. A female patient with chronic urticaria. Basic investigations were normal. And the ANA more than 1 into 640 titer. With nuclear homogeneous pattern with no other systemic involvement. Anti-dsDNA was normal. What is the next step of management? There were no causative drug or food allergen found.
Okay, now even though this is positive without any other problems there, I think we are justified in treating with a proper dose of antihistamines first. But if there is poor response to antihistamines, we may add a steroid like prednisolone or methylprednisolone, or those two are the preferred, or even dexamethasone, without waiting too much, right? We may be able to add a steroid quickly because of this positive ANA. But I think, like, say, as we all know, connective tissue disorders, they will not present with every feature at the same time. So the disease is in the evolving process. Therefore, you have to always keep it in your mind that this patient may end up with it may differentiate into one of the connective tissue disorders, either SLD or connective mixed MCTD or whatever. So you have to always keep that in mind and, you know, warn the patient if you develop anything unusual, come back for treatment.
Thank you, ma'am. And the next question is, I think, is there a place for oral antifungal when treating seborrheic dermatitis?
I do give oral antifungals rarely. the preferred one is itraconazole. I give it for a week or two. That is if it's very, very extensive, right? I have even treated patients with oral steroids if the inflammation is very bad, right? So of course, and remember, for itraconazole and dexamethasone both, and even azithromycin, we are actually using the anti-inflammatory function of that drug. If you all remember, all these three have an anti-inflammatory action, right? So you are treating the possible fungal element, plus you are giving a bit of anti-inflammatory treatment also. So that is why we are using doxycycline. I mean, why should we use doxycycline to treat a fungus? There you are using the anti-inflammatory action, right? But yes, you can use itraconazole. But if you're using it, use it 100 milligrams BD for at least 1 week. Just 1 or 2 days is not enough. The problem with itraconazole is the cost, right? For most patients, it's not an affordable drug.
Thank you, ma'am. Next question is, I think, out of our case scenarios. So please, a word around treatment of acne hyperpigmentation.
Acne hyperpigmentation. Okay. If your patient, I mean, one thing is you have to warn the patient that like almost everybody will get some hyperpigmentation with acne. When the acne resolves, it leaves a pigmentation. If you want it to get cleared quickly, stop meddling with the acne. Right? Second thing is, try and avoid sun exposure as much as possible, I mean, to the face. And the third thing is, like, the darker you are, the longer your pigmentation will persist. So acne pigmentation in my face would last longer than the pigmentation in your face, right? Therefore, I mean, you have to explain those things. Even with the things like adapalene, there is a bit of exfoliative action, and with that the pigmentation may go. But if it is really persistent, and especially think about patients who are having acne following whitening creams. Now, with whitening creams, what happens is they get this abnormal hypopigmentation on the face or whiteness, and the acne will look like they will be staring you in the face, like dark acne in a white face, right? So in that case, you have to treat it, okay? So in those conditions, there are two things you can use. One is, I mean, the most, now at the moment, I think kojic acid preparations are available. And this is the only time where you use only on the acne spot. Right now, if you are using adapalene or benzoyl peroxide on the face to treat acne, you have to treat the whole area, the whole cheek, not the acne spots. But here, when you are using kojic acid, you are going to use the kojic acid only on the acne spots at night. Right? Those are the things you can use. I mean, very severe ones, we can go for things like chemical peeling.
Thank you, ma'am. We are getting more and more questions. We are running out of time also. If you will not able to answer here, we will be surely
replying. Yeah, I'll be happy to answer with if you guys.
Yes, during the last lectures also, madam had given the answers, and we have distributed as a recorded answers, madam. And I'll just try to go through few important questions they have asked. The next question is, madam, blood donors who have acquired leishmaniasis need to be deferred permanently. Do you inform the patients regarding these issues?
What? I can you.
Blood donors who have acquired leishmaniasis need to be deferred permanently. I think deferred permanently from the.
I think here we are talking about visceral leishmaniasis, not cutaneous, because I told you cutaneous leishmaniasis does not visceralize, right? There's a test to do. Basically, I mean, in Sri Lanka, both in Javadhanapura and Colombo, they have done research and shown that cutaneous leishmaniasis does not visceralize. Therefore, if one of your patients gets a lesion or a nodule of cutaneous leishmaniasis and is treated, as far as I know, I think you have to get this, verified from the transfusion physicians. But as far as I know, I have never told my patients with cutaneous leishmaniasis not to donate blood. From what I can feel logically is, if you had visceral leishmaniasis, yes, because the organism is there in your bloodstream, right? Cutaneous leishmaniasis, I have not warned patients against donation of blood. But I think if cutaneous leishmaniasis is a contraindication for blood donation, I think when you're going for blood donation, that should be there in their checklist to cross, right? I haven't warned anybody.
All right. Thank you so much, madam, for that excellent explanation. We are receiving more and more questions. We will be answering for all of your questions personally. Please email us to the short email address if you have any specific questions, because some of the participants are asking, they have specifically to show some lesions to you, madam. So we'll get that from the email and we will clear it from you. And thank you so much for your patience to answer all the questions, madam. And I would like to thank you again on behalf of GMOA and Society for Health Research and Innovation. Thank you very much, madam.
Thank you.
So we are concluding our sessions today. Please find the link in the chat box. Kindly give your feedback, answer the post-assessment questions, and receive your e-certificate for your participation. And also, I would like to inform you, parallelly, we are running another lecture on COVID management. Actually, that lecture, the webinar has been arranged for pre-interns, but if you are really interested, you can join to the webinar. We will be sharing the links again in this chat box. Please find the link. If you have any specific questions, please email us to the previous email ID, which we have shown here. So thank you so much. That's the end of this webinar. Thank you. Have a good day.